John Engler graduated from Utah State University with an MA in American Studies in 2003, and then he graduated with an MFA in Nonfiction Writing from Pacific Lutheran University in 2011. He is currently a senior lecturer in the Utah State University Department of English, where he was recognized in 2015 as Lecturer of the Year. He teaches courses in research writing, nonfiction writing, and literature. He's the author of published essays, stories, and articles, and now 26 annual Valentine's Day poems due to his wife. That's adorable. He and his wife, Donette, who I think is here, right? Have lived in Smithfield for 20 years and have 6 children and 1 very cute grandson. And we are pleased to hear his presentation this morning entitled Unleashing the Editor in You. Come on, Professor Engler.
Hey, this is really great. It's great to see so many writers in one room together. That is just fantastic, and I love it. I'd especially like to thank Jason, who spent so much time organizing and putting together this conference for us today. Thank you for that kind introduction and welcome. And it's good to share the day with some other great writers. I just met Greg this morning, who's got some great classes today. And it looks like, is that Janet sitting next to him? I haven't met Janet yet, but hi, Janet. And Gail is where? Oh, hey, Gail. Good to meet Gail. And Gail's presenting today, too, and so is Nancy. And I don't know Nancy. We haven't met Nancy. She's still arriving. Okay, great. And it's an absolute honor to spend the day with these great writers. So accomplished, these writers, and published. And I just want to start out with a little levity today. I was thinking about, how do you know if you're a writer? You know if you're a writer if it bothers you to only have 9 things on your list instead of 10. That's the first thing. That's number 9. Number 8, you argue with yourself about whether you should mention grammatical errors to other people, right? You find yourself doing that? Your friends think you're ignoring them because you're writing instead of spending time with them. Does this, any of this sound familiar? Your story seemed like a great idea until page 147. Yeah? Your main character unexpectedly gets murdered on page 146. Yeah, right? You're at a party, you ask the host for a napkin, and immediately begin writing a new scene because of page 146, right? You've ever wondered if an MFA is the solution to all your problems? I thought about that too. It's not, by the way. You worry that your friends might recognize that your character sounds suspiciously like them. And the number one way you know you're a writer is you would like to pay the rent, but, well, you're a writer, so that's how this works. We have a good time as writers, and I think it's important that we spend some time laughing at ourselves. I titled this today, Unleashing the Editor in You, because, you know, editing is one of those not exciting things, so we had to come up with a good way to make it sound very exciting. Unleashing the Editor in You. One of the challenges that I have when I sit down to write is I have this little partner that, like a little apparition that kind of sits on my shoulder and while I'm writing, starts whispering in my ear. I don't know if you have a little writing partner like this. My partner, I've named him Vince. I named him Vince because Vince was a high school English teacher of mine. And he was a feisty Italian who just made me fall in love with words, right? When he went into a soliloquy on Hemingway, I just swooned, right? Vince was the guy. And Vince, I think the reason that I call this guy Vince that whispers in my ears, because what Vince did for me was he made me love writing so much that it never feels like what I'm writing is good enough, right, to be writing. And so I'm always hearing Vince in my ear and saying, it can be better, it can be better. And I went to find a picture of Vince on the internet so I could actually show you a picture of Vince. But would you believe? He doesn't exist on the internet. He's still alive in Watertown, Wisconsin. I found like an address record for him there, but he doesn't have a picture anywhere. I thought, what other kind of feisty, Italian, slightly balding man might represent Vince? So it was Colorado. So that's Vince, right? And I think it's really important to understand this guy. Do you have, let's go back. Do you have a little person like that who whispers in your ear like that? Do you know who that is for you? Do you name them? It might be a good idea to name them. Now, and we'll talk about this in a second, but I think part of the reason that teachers like Vince teach grammar and punctuation, and we all kind of grew up in that system where our papers came back with all these red marks on them and edits, right? And that's part of the system, and I think there's a few reasons for that. Our teachers, that's the way they were taught, and so that's the kind of teaching they know, and so that's how they taught us, and so we grew up learning that same way too, right? Error correction is a really quantifiable way to measure competency. Right? I can measure this. So many errors, this is right, this is wrong. If you're just saying the story is good or not good, those are harder kind of measurements to make, but an English teacher can say, oh, these are right and wrong, and then that's a straightforward way for a teacher to measure how good or bad a student is. Plus, there's this expectation that when students come out of an English class, they can produce error-free writing. I hear this all the time at the university. People from other departments come to me and say, what are you guys doing over there? My students come out of your classes and over to my classes and they still can't write. I've heard that many, many, many times. The expectation is that I can fix anything that they're doing and they will produce this error-free writing. And of course, we as longtime writers know that that's really not a reasonable expectation because writing is a lifelong learning process. So I think we have to give ourselves a little bit of a break and recognize that there is a system that helped create the Vinces in our lives that kind of whisper in our ear as we're writing. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to turn to a neighbor, and I want you to think about who's that little ghost or that little apparition that sits on your shoulder and whispers in your ear and says, we need to fix that spelling. Well, that's not right. The comma, you need to move the comma over here. Oh, that's not a good word, or make that sentence better, right? Who is that whispers in your ear? Give them a name. If you want to name them a fictional name, that's great. If you're a fiction writer and that's your thing, right, then do that. If you want to name them after somebody you know who has kind of engendered that in you, name them that. But just turn to your neighbor and describe and name your kind of whisperer in your ear, your middle of the sentence editor. Okay, just take 60 seconds. I see that some of you immediately knew who that was. Some of you feel very affectionate towards this person. I saw Emma over here. She was patting her shoulder like, this is my little friend. That's awesome. That's awesome, right? And maybe some of you don't have that same voice as I do or some of your peers do. And there's reasons for this. We look at the research behind this. Research shows that there are people, as they write, who are high self-monitors and others who are low self-monitors, right? People who are, as they're writing, they're kind of self-monitoring and very aware of what they're producing. Is it correct, incorrect, good, not good, right? You're very kind of self-aware. Other people who are not kind of as self-monitoring and they just write. Now my good wife here, I think she's a low self-monitor. She can just write and write and write and write. And it makes me kind of envious because I look over and I'm like, I would have stopped like 20 times just to kind of go back and fix stuff and correct things, right? That's my natural tendency is because I recognize that. Part of the problem of being an English teacher is you teach all that, and so you're extra aware of it and self-monitoring because that's part of my job is to monitor students' writing, and so it's hard for me to step out of that mode sometimes. So I get that. But research also shows that just because you're either a high self-monitor or a low self-monitor by nature doesn't mean you have to succumb to those impulses. that there are ways for us as writers to kind of step outside of that, and that's kind of what I want to talk about today. So that as writers, we're making conscious decisions. When am I being a high self-monitor? When am I being a low self-monitor? When's the right time to do which? So we want to talk about that. When do I want to engage in immediate correction, and when do I want to postpone correction? And there are times for each. There are times for each. And so, and as we kind of go through here today, I want to talk about how editing as a concept is not a ubiquitous thing. There are many levels and kinds of editing that we need to be doing, and that's kind of where I want to kind of go with you today as we kind of talk through this. In fact, I want to talk about three different kinds of editors. There are lots of different kinds of editors, but I want to kind of focus on three today. The editor-in-chief, the content editor, and the copy editor. And so we're going to talk about each of these three today. Okay? Now, the editor-in-chief is responsible for kind of the big picture decisions, right? Overall objectives, goals, maybe big storyline, or who's my audience, and they're making these big decisions about what a reader wants, what a reader's gonna enjoy, what have I got to produce, okay? My editor-in-chief is, I have a bad habit of naming all my people. My editor-in-chief is Jack. Jack is the name of my editor-in-chief in my head, my own kind of personal editor-in-chief editor in me. And he's kind of modeled after editor-in-chief that I worked for years ago as an undergraduate when I was a copy editor at BYU Studies, the journal that they publish quarterly out of BYU. John Welch was the copy editor, the editor-in-chief there, and he was for probably like 30 years. He was there forever and ever. And he just last year stepped away from that position. But Jack was amazing at figuring out how to take these manuscripts that were sent to us for publication and then put them in context for how they would fit and appeal to our readers. So, for example, I was doing copy editing on a manuscript that had come that analyzed the day that the LDS Church was first organized. Okay, so this is back in New York, and here's the day that it was organized, and so we're looking at this, and there's all these different historical accounts of that day, and some of the accounts line up, and some of the accounts have different versions of the events, and this manuscript was analyzing who said what and what sources could be trusted more or not, and Jack said to me, look, John, we need to step back from this and get a bigger picture of what this looks like. And he says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go and research all these accounts that are mentioned in this manuscript, and I want you to make a table. I want you to make a table, and each column on that table is one of the accounts, and each row on that table is all the events of that day that are mentioned in any of the accounts, and then you plot into that table, into that matrix, what that person said about that particular event that day. And so we can see it kind of like on one page. Which was a really genius way of doing it, right? You don't often think of an editor, because often our default mode of editor is fix spelling and commas. But the editor-in-chief looks at the big picture, takes a step back and says, how can we make this content more appealing and interesting to an audience? And that being a scholarly journal, his concept was, let's look at the bigger picture of this. And so I spent all this time doing all this research, built this table, and then he published my table. I'm just a little undergraduate at BYU, and he published my table right in the journal, right next to this article of all this analysis of what happened that day. That's the job of the editor-in-chief, right? So, turn to your neighbor and now name an editor-in-chief. Who for you is your editor-in-chief, like your internal editor-in-chief? Who would that be for you? Is that a person you know? Is that, can you want to give them a name? So turn to your neighbor again and pick an editor-in-chief. Name them, identify them, somebody you can associate with, somebody who's responsible for those big picture decisions, okay? Turn to your neighbor, go. What time do we have? Thank you. Okay, and you kind of named your editor-in-chief, your kind of little angel editor-in-chief. Just understand that you can, as a writer, it's probably a useful thing to step and say, okay, I'm going to put on my editor-in-chief hat now, whoever that is for you. Put on your editor-in-chief hat and say, this is the mode I'm going to be working in for the next little while, and I'm not going to be allowing Vince into my life for now. Vince is over, I'm not Vince right now, I'm Jack. And for the next while, whether it's a day, a week, a month, a year, I'm going to be only Jack. And just be Jack for a while. And push Vince off the side. You don't want Vince right now. Nice guy, Vince, but don't let him in. Okay? Set him aside. We'll get back to that here in a minute. But what? Vince, don't let him do that with bringing your course. Okay? Now, make a note to yourself. Would you just kind of jot down, what's a piece of writing you're working on right now? Think about how many pages you've kind of got in your draft right now. What number draft? Is this a first draft, second draft, third draft? Where are you at on this? Just kind of make a note to yourself for a moment. Kind of think about something you're working on right now. We're going to talk about some how Jack might approach wherever you're at, okay? Now, in order to talk about Jack, I need to talk about somebody else first. And before I talk about her, I need to tell you a story about a pottery class. Anybody ever thrown pottery on a wheel? A few of you have, maybe? Yeah, I kind of had a disastrous event the first time I tried to throw pottery on a wheel. I wanted to make a big mug. You know, like coffee mugs are just like regular size? I want a big mug. So my wife's dad runs when he taught high school, he ran the pottery shop at the high school. And so we were visiting, and I'm like, can we go over, and I want to throw a big mug. So I'd never done anything before on a wheel, and I sit down, and I kind of works. You know, I pull up this mug, and I got a mug, and I'm like, ooh, that's going to be an awesome big mug. I stuck a handle on it, and then they put it out to dry and fired it and the whole deal. And I got home, and I set it next to my regular mug, and it's like, little. Like, nobody told me it was going to shrink when it dried. So I had a little mug. Right? Throwing pottery is a tough thing to figure out how to do well, right? It's tricky to figure out. So the research, this is a piece of research that I've read about, but I still have yet to track down the original source. So this might be anecdotal, but the researcher goes into a pottery class, and he splits the class in half. And he says, this half of the class, I want you to focus only on making one piece of high-quality pottery. That's all you have to do the whole semester long, one piece of high-quality pottery. This half of the class says, I don't care about the quality of your pottery. Your grade is going to be based on the weight of pottery you produce. So 50 pounds of pottery is an A, 40 pounds is a B, 30 pounds is a, I don't care what it looks like. And they set this class loose, half focusing on this one piece of high quality, the other half just focusing on mass quantity. And then at the end of the semester, they came in and did an analysis. And I said, which group produced the higher quality pottery? The group focused on this one piece of high quality work, or this group not looking at quality at all, but focused on quantity. Do you have a guess?
Yes.
The group that produced the highest quality pottery was the quantity group. Right? It kind of flies in the face sometimes of what we think about producing high quality material. And yet, it actually rings true. How many of you have played a musical instrument of some kind? How many times have you been through a piece, right? Over and over and over again, right? My son runs cross country and track for Skyview. Last year, he was logging his miles as he ran, his training runs, his races, you know, his afternoon runs. And he got to the end of the year and realized he had logged for the year 2,000 miles of running, right? Why does he do that? That's like that's a long ways to run, right? That's almost across the country, right? Why run all that? Because we know that practice makes perfect, right? So it only makes sense that a pottery class would go in and the people who had more practice, who maybe weren't worried or obsessed or stressed about making just the one perfect piece of pottery, it makes sense why they would produce the higher quality pottery, doesn't it? Now, when I have students come into my classroom, and we have a research paper to do or a short story to write, what happens? What do they produce? They produce one almost perfect draft, and then when I say, okay, now go revise that, they tweak a few things, edit it, and turn it in. Have you or I ever been guilty of that? Have we done that as writers?
Yeah.
Why do we do that? Why do we think that that's a good way to produce high quality work? It kind of flies in the face of what we know about music, running. An NBA basketball player, for every one free throw that they shoot in a game, how many do you think they shoot in practice? How many do you think they shoot in practice? Would you believe that the number is 300 for every one that they shoot in a game? And they still miss a bunch of them, right? They still miss a bunch. I can't believe how many they miss, right? They still miss a bunch, right? That practicing is so important, the repetitive nature of practicing. And it finally dawned on me when I met a writer named, this is a great name, Anne Pancakes. Has anybody ever read any of Anne Pancake's work? These are three of her books that she wrote. She is a West Virginia writer from Appalachia, and she writes with her characters from Appalachia, set in Appalachia. She is a fantastic writer. She, in her prize-winning book called Given Ground, this was her dedication. For the people where I grew up who taught me what's important in the story. Like, she just is in that place. That's her. That Appalachia kind of territory is her place. And it's just some beautiful writing. I've got like a little passage here I want to read to you guys. Listen to this stuff. I opened the gap into the pasture, a single strand of barbed wire notched in a twist. The cold came high in my chest, but the wind had finally laid. From some distance, I could feel the heat off the horse. A hide odor off the horse, that soily smell he carried even in the winter. I pushed my face into it, into the hollow behind the shoulder, before the belly swell. Old, patient horse, indifferent horse. 27 years old, born on my grandfather's farm. Had outlived both him and my daddy now. The dogs at the edge of the yard, and bayed nothing, just bayed. I turned my cheek to his skin and looked down towards the creek, to the sycamores, ghost trees, bone shiny in the littlest moon. My daddy had said, just put him under the big tree. Just some gorgeous, gorgeous writing. Now, Anne explained to me how she writes her drafts, and it just blew my mind. This was probably back in 2012, and it completely changed my life as a writer. Anne says, when I sit down to write a novel, I pull out a regular old Mead notebook, you know, spiral-bound Mead notebook. I open it up, I take my pen, and I start writing. And I write my novel in that notebook. And sometimes it takes two or three or four notebooks to write my novel, but I write it out by hand. And when I'm done with that, she says, I take that stack of Mead notebooks and I set it over here, and I open a brand new Mead notebook, and I start writing my novel from the beginning again. I'm like, what? Not only are you writing by hand, but you're writing it a second time from the beginning? Sometimes she'll reference that first one that she wrote. Sometimes she won't even open it. She'll write that novel a second time. She might even do it a third time before she ever goes to the computer and starts to key it into the computer. And then she'll probably key it into the computer two or three times. And I told Anne, I emailed Anne a month ago, and I said, like, I'm gonna be at this Logan Writers Conference. I just wanna make sure I've got this right. This is how you do this. She says, yeah, that's right. And I said, how many drafts of a novel are usually produced? And she says, I don't know, it might be 10 to 12. 10 to 12 drafts of a novel. Now, that's a lot of work, right? That's a lot of work. Does it make sense? Kinda, yeah. Does it sound easy? Not even a little bit, right? So it was the last day, it was the graduation day of my MFA program, and I was at Pacific Lutheran in Tacoma, Washington. I was sitting in my dorm room and my phone rang. I pick up the phone. And because I've been thinking, what am I going to do with this MFA degree now that I've got it, right? I pick up my phone and it's a friend of mine from Provo. and she says, "Hey, John, we're working on this movie. How'd you like to be involved in this?" I'm like, "Really? Like, that sounds really cool." And so I got involved with them working on the movie. Now, they didn't ask me to be a screenwriter. They asked me to just come be involved. They knew I was a writer. They knew I kind of had interest. They knew I taught up here. And so they thought, well, maybe John can work with us on this. And so I started off with them, and we were doing some promotion work, and we were doing some advertising, doing some design work. But they had a different screenwriter who was working on the film. In fact, they had the second screenwriter. One screenwriter had tried. It hadn't quite worked out. They'd given it to another screenwriter, and they were working on it. 6 months after I started working with this group, they came to me and said, "John, how'd you like to be the screenwriter for our film?" I'm like, "Really? That would be fantastic." Like, I had no training in screenwriting, but I'm like, "Yeah, you bet, I'll write a movie." And so I started writing this movie. And I said, "You know, when do you want to have this done? I mean, I could have it to you in a few months." And they're like, "Oh, wait a minute, a few months?" I said, "Do you think you could write like 20, 25 pages in a week?" I'm like, "Well, maybe. I mean, that's like, you know, 4 or 5 pages a day. I could probably, if I was really working on it, I could probably do that." And they said, "Well, good. That means you can have it to us in 6 weeks." Wow, right? And I realized this is what the professional world looks like, right? This is not monkeying around. This is not school anymore. This is the real deal. And so I cranked out a draft in 6 weeks. Full-length movie, screenplay. And I sent it to them, and they didn't like it. They were like, "Well, not really. I'm gonna try again." And so over the course of the next year, I wrote several more drafts. 6, 7, 8, I think I probably am at 11 or 12 drafts. And most of them have some similar components to them, but the storylines are different in some of them, the endings are different in almost all of them. A whole variety just to keep throwing different stuff at them. Now this screenplay was a little bit tricky to write because it's a historically based film based on the life of Emma Smith, the wife of the prophet Joseph Smith, after he died, right? Her life after he's dead. Like, nobody knows that story. Everybody knows the story of her with him, but after he died, nobody knows that story. So I had to do loads and loads of research to start with. And then I had to try to take all the what research we do have, and of course, all historical research has lots of gaps, right? Our history major over here might have lots of gaps. And I had to try to fill that in and create a narrative line that would work for a movie. That was really, really challenging. And so I kind of pushed through that, and then they got to the point where they said, "You know, this really isn't going to work. Thanks for all your work on this. We're giving this to a different screenwriter." And they took my script and all the work I'd done, and they gave it to another screenwriter. And a year later, they said, "Okay, we've got the screenplay." A couple of times during that time, they would call me and say, "Hey, we want to check up on the research," because I was still their like research expert. They would call me and check up on the research. And I'm like, "I don't know if I want to tell you the reason. I don't know if I want to give you the answer, because you just took this movie away from me," right? But, you know, you come to understand that screenwriting especially, and I think some writing is like this also, it's collaborative work that we do. And you don't always get to have your own way and your own say in all these things, right? So they finally finished the script, and they produced the movie, and they released it, and it was in theaters, and you know, it was great, right? But it wasn't my movie anymore. There were some scenes of mine in there, and it was kind of fun to see that, and these characters I had been living with for a while. But in a way, it kind of felt like I really failed at that, right? I wasn't able to kind of make the movie I knew I wanted to make. And so, even despite 10 or 12 drafts. So I've come to call this technique pancake writing, after any pancake, right? This idea of many drafts. Many, many drafts. 6, 8, 10, 12 drafts. If you're doing fewer than 6 drafts, it's hard for me to imagine how it gets to the level of quality that you really want. Many of these drafts, you might think about writing by hand or by typewriter. I've read about writers who write by typewriter instead of computer. Why? To get Vince off their shoulder, right? Because on a typewriter, you can't go back and edit. It's now already on the page, right? So writing by hand or by typewriter pushes you through the material, possibly from scratch, many of those drafts. Start from scratch. Possibly writing those drafts without referencing the earlier drafts. Can you imagine how good a book could be if you've written it 5, 6, 7 times from scratch each time? You see how that repetitiveness could, like, ooh, I've really found the groove here. I've really worked this kink out in here. That's this idea of pancake writing. No, I'm trying to kind of gauge what your response is to this. Like, are you thinking, this guy is crazy talking about this? I have my students do this. They write research papers, and I don't tell them I'm gonna have them write a pancake draft after they write their research papers. I write your paper, and they always write a nearly perfect first draft. Because that's what they do, right? They don't wanna, they're trying to be efficient and not waste their time on a second draft. After they finish that first draft, I said, okay, that's actually not gonna be your paper, because now you need to write a pancake draft. You need to set aside that first draft. Don't even look at it. I want you to write a second draft from scratch without looking at the first draft, without looking at your notes. Just write it from here. Write it from your gut, your heart, your gut, and just write it. And they freak out, as you might imagine. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Yeah, right? They kind of freak out and they panic. And I say, look, it doesn't need to be perfect. It doesn't need to take you a long time. Here's the due date. Just sit down and just start writing. It doesn't matter if it's any good at all, because you've already got the first draft there. Worst case scenario, you can throw away this pancake draft and go back to the first draft. There's no risk, right? There's no risk. And so they dive in and they do it, and I bet 85 to 90% of them come back to me and they say, I love doing that. That was fun. That was the first time in my life I enjoyed writing. Because they found what we as writers know about writing is that the joy of the writing, the discovery right along the way. But sometimes we're so kind of caught up in getting it right in the middle of a sentence, in the middle of a story. We're so worried about getting it just right that we tighten up and we worry and we stress. And we lose the creativity and the expression and the art of writing. And pancake writing allows us kind of that freedom to know, oh, I'm going to do this draft, and you know what? If it's junk, I can throw it away and I can do another one, right? It's what every musician has to do. It's what every athlete has to do. You just do it over and over and over again. A writer named David Beispiel wrote a book called Every Writer Has a Thousand Faces. And he analyzes the way artists, painters, work. Which is just like this, right? They sketch something, they sketch again. Have you ever seen an artist sketchbook? It's just filled with the same images over and over and over again, right? We as writers, I think, could learn something from visual artists in how we work. And we can do kind of the same idea. David, but he says, this is the liberating message. Failure is the engine of creativity. Working past the brink of failure, being free to try and discard and try again, is what allows the creative process to playfully flourish, keeping the spirit open to unexpected discovery. Right. Aim to maximize failure. Right. Failure is the path to art. Aim to maximize failure. So, I failed my screenplay. And I celebrate that. I love that I failed at that. I love that I was able to push through all those drafts. And that even though the movie's out, it's called In Emma's Footsteps. And I don't think it's a very good movie. I really don't. Like, my stuff is about half of that script, and I don't think it's a very good movie. I think the historical aspect of it, I think getting the history of Emma's life after Joseph's death, I think that part of it's good. But in terms of being a, you know, an Academy Award winning film, I don't think it is.
Sorry, I just kind of want, you said that you celebrated like the failure and everything, yeah. And the quote came to mind. It's actually from a video game I like, but it says the difference between a master and a novice is the master has tried more times than the novice has failed.
That's right. That's absolutely right. Video games are a great example of celebrating failure, right? Like, that is the whole life of the gamer. do it again and again and again. Hit those levels, hit level two, hit level three, hit level three, hit level three. Oh, now I'm on level four, right? That's the whole idea. And so as writers, I think we have something to learn from that. So that's the editor-in-chief who does that. That's the editor-in-chief. You remember your name of your editor-in-chief? Mine's Jeff. All right, your editor-in-chief. Now, let's move on to the content editor. We're going to run short on time. We're going to talk about the content editor for a minute. Content editor is the one who takes those many, many drafts, all that content, and now shapes it so it becomes art. My content editor, her name is Karen. She was a team lead for me when I worked as a technical writer for a couple of years. And she doesn't live on the internet either. I couldn't find a picture of her. So I got it late by this. Because Karen was kind of feisty like Elaine is, and Karen was awesome. But Karen, like in the 6 months I worked for her, and then I went on to another job as a tech writer, but in the 6 months I worked for Karen, she transformed my expectation of precision writing, of crafting sentences and getting every sentence just right. Now it's important not to do that or worry about that until that editor-in-chief has done their work, but now we can move on to the content editor and we can work those sentences over, okay? Think about, just take 30 seconds, maybe don't turn to your neighbor here because we're running short on time. Who represents your content editor for you? Give them a name. Visualize them. Who is that for you? Who's your content editor? Who's the person who can help you shape your sentences into great sentences? Now, I thought this was funny. Russian nesting dolls, so I got the Russian writers. I'm the Russian nesting doll. The idea with content editing is to work from big to small. Don't start with the right word in a sentence. Start big and go small. So start with plot. I think Greg's teaching a class today on white knuckled action and like plot, like driving forward on a plot, right? I think we need that kind of stuff, and so I think that'll be great. Characters gotta have great lovable or hateable characters, right? I think Gail's teaching a class on characters later today, so that'd be a good one to catch. Scenes, have you captured them in verisimilitude? You know what verisimilitude? Verisimilitude is just like real life, as close to real life as you can. Have you really captured those scenes? Paragraphs, are they cohesive, right? You're making a paragraph breaks in the right places. And then finally, sentences and words, are they precise and artful? But you start big, don't start small. Start with the big stuff and work to small as a content editor. Okay. Once you've got the big stuff sorted, once you know you've got that plot, that narrative line in place, then you can move on. The next, and the next, and the next. Sometimes you have to kind of bounce back and forth and work with multiple, but start big and go small. The LAR factor. The LAR factor is what I call that thing. You know, you're the student who writes their paper and realizes they're a page and a half short and needs to fill it up to get to your word length, right? Here's the problem. We are all products of that system. And so we have been trained so well to naturally produce the LAR factor. Even when we don't mean to, we still do. And so it's really important, right? And so I think we have to recognize that, and we could spend a lot of time talking about this, but there are reasons why we have kind of all learned how to do that well and produce extra words that aren't needed. And I think we as writers need, this is the content editor that goes in and just cleans that out, gets rid of all that lard, and tightens up the writing. I had some practice here that we could do. Let's do this one. Take 2 minutes. Rewrite, this is a piece that would go maybe in a piece of nonfiction writing, maybe a magazine article. This is a sentence that a student turned in. Then I think there's a high LAR factor in this sentence. Can you just in your notes quickly write a better version of this sentence than this one? Can you just write a better version of that sentence than that one? Can you do it in like half as many words? Do it. Try it. Just try it. Just try it. Take 90 seconds in your own notes. Write a better version of the sentence. This is what we writers like to do. This should feel familiar to you, right? This process of taking a sentence and making a better version of it, right? Should feel familiar to you. The trick is that we have to do this with our own writing, not always with somebody else's writing. That's the hard part, isn't it? Here's my version, right? Many waiting organ transplants could have their lives saved by this cloning method. Note that this first version, there's actually a semantic problem here. What is the organ donor list? There's not really a list of organ donors, and that's not what they mean. They mean the people waiting for organs. And so sometimes you read it and you're like, oh, I didn't even recognize the semantic problem there. So you really have to dive in and make sure you're getting precise and exact with what you mean to say. Make sure it reads the way you actually mean it. This is the job of the content editor, right? And this is all the way down to the bottom of that list after we've gone through plot and character and scenes, and now we're trying to really iron out the precision level of the writing, okay? And then finally, the copy editor, okay? Editor-in-chief, content editor, now we're down to the copy editor, right? And this is the person that's responsible for the corrections, the mechanical errors in your grammar, your punctuation, syntax, those types of things, right? Mine's named Gretchen. She's a friend of mine who works as a professional tech writer in Rochester, out of Rochester, New York, and she's just a consummate professional, right? And so when I think about somebody cleaning up and tightening up those mechanical errors, right, then I think of Gretchen, okay? Think about who's your copy of, right? Who's the person who cleans that up for you? It's useful, again, to kind of think of these as individual people, and you're, okay, I'm going to put on Jack's hat first, then I'm going to put on Karen's hat, then I'm going to put on Gretchen's hat, and I'm going to be the copy editor. But don't put on the Gretchen hat until all the other stuff is done. This is the very, very last step. And I just want to talk about this concept right here. Use an editing checklist. I learned this when I worked at BYU Studies for the copy editor. We had a checklist of probably 25 or 30 items that we had to clean up and make sure every manuscript was clean on every one of these 30 items. And the job of the copy editor was to read the whole manuscript one time for each line item on that checklist. So first I'd read it for misplaced modifiers, then I'd read it for subject-verb agreement, then I'd read it for rivers of white, right, where the gaps, the spaces between words all kind of lined up and created what they called this river of white down the page. So we got really precise and exacting, but I had to read the manuscript once for each item on the checklist, focusing only on that one thing. There's a real advantage, as you can imagine, to doing that. It takes a little time, but it can really clean up your writing. If you have this checklist, and you want to make your own custom checklist, include the errors that you know you've kind of commit. But if you have this checklist and you know, that's in my drawer, and when I'm ready to copy edit, all I have to do is grab that checklist. That frees you up from worrying about all those mechanical errors during the editor-in-chief stage, during the content editor stage, right? Produce the content, and then you'll get to the cleanup, and that's fun when you get there. But get rid of Vince, as nice a guy as he is, get rid of that little guy whispering in your ear to fix all those little mechanical things early. Don't do it early. Okay. Pat McNeese, who's a professional editor, she uses 8 different checklists. So you can see that we talked a little bit about the substantive edit, the line edit, the copy edit, were kind of what we talked about today, but she's got all these other ones. So there's lots of ways to tackle this, but checklists are a great way to kind of manage the editing. And here's one more thing, last thing. The best friend of the editor The absolute best friend of the editor is time. Give yourself the time, after you've completed a draft, to put it away. Put it away for as long as you can, a few days at least, maybe a few weeks, months maybe, and then pull it out. And you will see that with new eyes, and suddenly you will be a, you'll look at that as like, did I write this really? This is awful. And you'll do a next best version of it. Greg's laughing because he knows, right? Yeah, he knows, right? The best friend of the editor is time. If you can manage it, you can see with new eyes if you can leave your time. So thank you very much for your time today. Unleashing the editor in you. Thank you.